we are in awe of the love and grace you continue to shower us with, and we relish in last week's message of hope and new life. We are grateful for the opportunity to trust you more, to know you more, and to see your wonder-working power in every aspect of our daily lives. Father, bless Dawn as she shares your message with us this morning. Thanks be to you, Holy Father, for your incredible gift of salvation and eternal life, and that you are being the Lord of our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's continue on page 377.
Let it be used in service to you. We ask this in your name. open heart surgery this week, and she's doing great, much better than the doctor expected.
That is a true blessing. God's miracle. Anybody else? Grants, I know y'all got stuff to be thankful for, y'all got three to get out of school, right? Only a crank up from more school. Oh, well, good comes with a bad. Anybody else?
The piano lessons that Beth's mind are paid for.
We have truly been blessed with our pianists, Pam Clark and now Sarah, on a lot of churches, and that kind of talent. Oh, and Donna Ruth, yes.
Well, that book is actually, I had to play for a wedding probably, I don't know, 10 or 12 years ago. And I called Donna Ruth and I said, you have anything? Anyway, there's an arrangement of Say You're Like a Shepherd, lead us in. So this is actually her book that I play all the time. And it's a really special one for Diane Butler, too, so.
That's awesome.
Dee, last Sunday, Michael was in church with us. Sarah plus that.
She sure did, I remember that. That is so great.
And she has played several times since then, just.
It is beautiful.
Both versions of There's That One and the traditional.
It's like God reaches out and gives us what we need when we need it, without us really realizing it. Anybody else? Yes, sir.
Well, my mother has spoke to doctors again. She's 98.5 years old.
And still kicking and going strong.
Came through this last episode.
Awesome.
They were not real hopeful, so praise the Lord.
Amen. Does anybody have any update on Mike McGee? Anybody?
He is off the ventilator. He's still a little confused. They're dealing with some issues with his kidneys, but he's come a long way.
He has, because it was not looking good the first of the week. So we praise the Lord for that. That again is another praise and continued prayers. We have all, in some way, in this church, been blessed and been giving reprieve and great thanksgiving from God. I don't know anybody in here that can't say that in some form, shape, or fashion, that God has touched their own lives in a miraculous way these last 3 years. So we are in itself a very blessed and thankful church, and we should sing praises for that. Are there any other that we need to remember sick in the hospital? I know that we're still in prayer for Maggie McKee's family after losing her son-in-law.
Hobson Tony, we need to continue to remember Hobson.
Yes, Hobson Tony. He's still hanging in there?
Hanging.
Okay. And Amy McCrady, her mother-in-law passed away this past Friday morning. I know that I sent out a notice on it. I think it was Thursday morning. But anyway, we need to be in prayer for that family because I don't think that was expected. So, you know, sometimes the waiting can be hard, but the unexpected sometimes when it takes you by surprise, takes you a little bit of time to adjust to what's happened. So we definitely need to be in prayer for them. Are there any others?
Linda talked to me this morning. Roger can be better, but he still has some issues. So God is good.
God is good. He's great. That's wonderful. And we stay in prayer for you and Roger always.
We feel the prayer.
Good. That's what they're for. Uplifting. Prayer is uplifting itself. Okay? There being none, let's go ahead and may the Lord be with you.
Oh,
heads bowed, our hearts humbled. You know what lays heavy on each of our hearts. You know the joys, the praises, the thanksgivings, mentioned and unmentioned. Lord, you heard the request for healing hand and for the healing of souls and hurt hearts. We ask, Lord, that you do your will with each and every one. Give the comfort that is needed. Let the faith and strength be brought forward. We ask, Lord, that you give us the guidance we need to reach out to help in any way that we can those that are hurting. And Lord, let us always remember that you are there for us, whether it's a small thing or a big thing. We ask so much of you, and we thank so much for you. And now we'll begin with another thanks and praying the words that Jesus Christ gave us. Our
Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Amen.
Thank you.
becomes allergies. And they happen to be this morning. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for the opportunity to gather here in your name, to hear your word, to worship you in freedom, to join together as one in the body of Christ, to be a church filled with love, with care, and with hope. We ask, Lord, that you open our eyes that we may see, open our ears that we may hear, open our hearts that we will hear the word you wish us to hear today. Be with us, Lord, as we go out through this week. Help us to be better servants for you. Help us to turn to you in all things and not just some things. Help us to sing and shout out your praises and your many blessings you've given us in the good times and in the bad. We ask for the forgiveness of our sins. We ask for all that we have. Be blessed by you. We ask all of this in your name and in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. It's been a long time, so you're going to have to bear with me a little bit. The reading today is coming from John 20, 19 through 31. And we all know that Christ first appeared to Mary Magdalene. And what we're going to be studying today are the two appearances he made to the disciples. The first one was made 8 days after he was risen. We'll start with chapter 19. I'm going to be reading from the NIV. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I also send you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, their sins are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." Now Thomas, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my finger where the nails were and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. See my hands. Reach your hand out and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen me and yet have believed." Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. This is the word of God for the people of God. In this passage, there's a lot of things that, you know how I've always said you can read scripture over and over and over again. And depending on where you're at in your life, it always takes a different meaning for you. It has a different impact if you read it with an open heart. Having read this many times, I can honestly say I have a different impact. And I catch different things each time I read it. One of the things that stuck out to me was the fact that the Bible says they were in the locked upper room due to fear. They were in great fear. They were in mourning.
they were in despair. They were lost. These past 2 years, well, I'm skipping. I want to show you something else. When you think, I want you to think about this too. When he appears to them, okay, they're locked in this room, they're scared, all of that I just said. And this is something I thought about when I read the scripture. Can you imagine what the disciples felt before they saw Jesus? And probably even after. We have to think about the guilt that they had to have embedded in them. Peter had already denied him 3 times. The other disciples simply abandoned him and went in hiding. They were not going out and doing as Jesus taught them. They were not going out and giving the word. They were not going out and comforting. They were hiding in fear, despair, and loss. They didn't have their leader anymore. They didn't know what to do. They failed him. When he needed them the most, they ran. Tucked tail and ran, as they say. Now, during the last 2+ years, we've been in our own lockdown. Due to COVID, we've had businesses shut down, churches shut down, schools shut down. We've been told to isolate in our homes. We've been told to stay away from people. We've been told all kinds of things. People have gotten sick. People have died. More people have gotten sick. More people have died. This has just been a continuous thing. This is our new normal. And us being humans, I know me for myself, you know, texting or calling or talking on the phone or watching a video is one thing. I want that human contact. I want to hear that voice face to face. I want to see somebody, the love or the sympathy or the like or the dislike. I want to see it in their face, eye to eye. Personal contact. That's what I've grown on. And I don't know about the rest of you guys, but that's what I miss the most, is that human personal contact. And I will tell you honestly, coming up here and sitting in that office all by my little lonesome every day for months at a time was hard. But at least if I could get out of my house. Some people didn't even get to do that. So we've been in our own prison. We've been in our locked up in our own fears. We've had 11 members to pass from the middle of 2020 to the middle of 2021. Now these were not members who came 2 or 3 times a year. These were members that came every Sunday. Now yes, they were elderly. Yes, they had wonderful lives. Yes, they were blessed. But we could not mourn them. We couldn't gather at a funeral or a service because during those times, during that specific time, you couldn't have more than 10 people at a funeral. They wouldn't do a graveside service with more than 10 people. I myself lost relatives, and it was the same situation. So you had to find a way to mourn. And that only brought more despair. And then we had people who, elderly and otherwise, and I myself thrive on coming to church. It makes my week. It gives me what I need to make it to the next day. It feeds me. And then you have people that aren't getting fed. Yes, we had the videos going, but not everybody does videos. Not everybody, guess what, does not do YouTube. They don't do Facebook. So where did they go? What happened to them? They're even more isolated and more separated than the rest of us. We have so many ways to communicate and reach out to each other. But one of the things I found the most helpful during that time period was the good old telephone. Not texting, not video, telephone. don't email, call them up.
Talk to them.
Now, I will admit, I got into some very long-winded conversations that I couldn't get out of because they felt better, I felt better. We fed off of each other. That unlocked that upper room to a point. Then we started gathering back to church. We slowly come back to wonderful attendance. So we're lighting ourselves up again. We're doing what the Lord called us to do. The next thing that Jesus does is he gives them a sending out message. He tells them, just as the Lord sent me, my Father sent me, I am sending you. Now we all know when we accept Christ, when we accept our salvation, what is the first thing we're supposed to do? Anybody? Spread the word. And you can spread it in so many ways. You can spread it verbally. You can spread it text messaging, Facebook. You can spread it email. Or you can spread it with a smile, or a thank you, or an extended hand. Or you could write, I know this has happened to me, somebody gets real ugly with you in the grocery store or in a parking lot. And you said, well, I hope you have a very nice day. And you walk away with a smile on your face. And that person just stands there going, what did she just say to me? But it takes time to pause and think. That is a form of forgiveness as well. And that is what Jesus did when he went to the disciples, and the first words he spoke was, peace be with you. The main things that Christ taught was peace and forgiveness. Okay? Peace comes with forgiveness and vice versa. The next thing he does is he follows all of this up with the breathing of the Holy Spirit. He indwells the Holy Spirit into those disciples. He lights their fire. He gives them what they need to pep up, get out of that locker room, and go do what they were called to do, what he trained them to do, what he taught them needed to be done. He gave them the encouragement they needed. And you know, I had to really think hard about the section where he says you have an ability or the power to forgive sins or not to forgive them. I'm thinking, well, wait a minute. I just, you know, I thought only God could do that. But what he's saying is, in my opinion, and I am no scholar, don't mean to sound like I am, but in this day, today, what that means to me is that if somebody wrongs you, you have a choice. You forgive them or you don't forgive them. Okay, say Diane really makes me mad, and she said some ugly things to me that were uncalled for, and I can do two things. I can say, well, she was having a bad day, and let it just slide right off. Or I can let it sit there and fester and fume and get mad every time I look at her. There's no forgiveness. There's no peace. What's more important? He's not saying, and he does go on to say that if you forgive it, it'll come to you. If you retain the sin or forgive that sin, or you know, refuse to forgive that sin, you carry that with you. Okay? Y'all hear that? You carry it. It doesn't go away. You have it now. Not only do they still have the sin, but you got it too. And it can turn up. So we have to be careful about what we choose to forgive and not forgive. And at this point, it needs to be expressed that we're not talking about somebody who's murdered somebody or committed some horrible crime. That's not that kind of forgiveness we're talking about here. And that's not what Christ was talking about. He's talking about the forgiveness that brings peace. Because you have to have peace. He tells them, don't be unbelieving, be believing. Now we have to look at ourselves and ask our own selves, do we believe or are we not believing? And when I say that, I mean into our new normal. You know, we've made choices on church? Where are we gonna sit? Are we gonna mask up? Are we gonna keep a 6-foot distance? Those are new normals, and I'm telling you, I honestly don't believe those are going away. But we make that choice. And one of the things I question myself during all that time is, at what point am I not believing? Because we can let that prevent us from being the hands and feet of God. That can prevent us because we have that excuse to say, whoa, you know, COVID, back up, gotta have a distance. And refuse to speak the word or to give the comfort. Let me give you a little warning on that. When you reach out to somebody, do you reach out to them from the heart or because you're a good Southern person? And we have such hospitality in our Southernness. If you reach out to them in hospitality only, and they respond to you, yes, I could use your help, what are you doing? Well, okay. What are we looking at here? How can I help you? And if they say, if you could just come and do this for me or that for me or spend this day here, or and you're sitting there, your mind is boggled and you're going, whoa, what about? And then finally you just say, I'm so sorry, that's not gonna work for me. Well, why didn't you offer to help the community? If you do it from your heart, if you extend help from your heart, and then they say to you, yes, you can help me, you will find a way to do what they're asking you to do. Does anybody disagree with that? It's like, you know, with your kids and your grandkids, if they got something coming up and they really want you to be there, you're going to bust through that to be there. No matter what, nothing's going to stop you. It's the same thing. Everything we do has to come from the heart. Why from the heart? Because guess where the Spirit indwells? In the heart. If we're going to be the hands and feet, we've got to do, our actions have to come from the heart. Like I said before, Thomas was not present, so he didn't believe. He said, I'm not going to until I touch him. And then Jesus appears again a week later, and Thomas is there. And Jesus gives him the opportunity to do exactly what he wanted. To put his fingers through his holes in his hands. To put his hand through his hole in his side. He said, do this, Thomas, and believe. But Thomas, there's no written documentation that Thomas ever took Jesus up on that opportunity. When he saw him, he believed. No more doubt. And Jesus goes on to say to him, because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed. Now, what does that mean? Folks, that's for us. That's for those to come after. Jesus left us a path to see and believe without actually visibly seeing. The testament that the disciples carried on with through the Holy Spirit, the fact that the Holy Spirit comes into us at the time that we believe, gives us the strength and faith we need to believe he's real without seeing him. I mean, how many times have you been sitting with someone and somebody, or listening to Sarah play a piece? Diane, you said that stirs you. Okay? Stirs what? Stirs your heart. Where's your heart? Who's in your heart? The Holy Spirit. It gets stirred, whether we want to admit it or not. The thing that we need to recognize is when it's stirred, and what we need to do is calm ourselves and listen to what it's telling us. I say it, what he is telling us. Because that's a way for God to send you word. You know, how many times do we pray and say, give me a sign, give me a sign? And it's like, you know, you hear that old joke about God comes, he's up on the roof, and helicopter comes, no, I'm good. Boat comes, no, I'm good. God's going to save me. And then he sends somebody else, God's going to save me. said, why did you save these that I sent for the people and you just throw them away? I mean, it, that sounds like ha-ha, yeah, it's funny, but it's also an aha thing. Because how many times have we had that happen to us? Like, this is what's happening with the disciples now. They are being stirred to live a life of servitude in whatever form, shape, or fashion that may look like. And God, well, Jesus says that blessed are going to be those that believe without seeing. So, yes, he gave the disciples blessings. The Holy Spirit, he breathed himself into them. But when you look at it overall, how much more blessed are we that we have the opportunity to believe without seeing? How much stronger is our faith when we didn't get to see firsthand anything Jesus did? And there are times in our lives when things are going wrong. And I know in my own, you know, you just think, I've never asked God why. I've asked him, what did I do that I forgot to ask forgiveness for? But the reality is, God does not do this stuff to me. And I hate to say he lets things happen, because I don't think that either, but things happen to us, whether it's good or bad, and we need to recognize that it happens because we are being spoken to. It happens because the end result, if we choose the right path, is going to lead to a stronger relationship with God. We are going to be closer to him and in a better relationship. And as a result of that, things could be falling around, apart around me, and I still feel, okay, it's good. We're okay. And I'll tell you honestly, I'm experiencing that right now with my parents. And it's like, all right, we got this guy. We'll be fine. He gives us what we need. We just have to take it and recognize it. And that's what Jesus is doing to the disciples. He's given them everything they need. To me, the purpose of Thomas's doubt or not believing was to show all of us that we can believe without seeing. Many Christians have been strengthened in their faith by this gospel alone, and many others have been brought to faith, in a manner of speaking, by its witness to Christ. Stop not believing. Embrace the Holy Spirit that indwells in you. Let him stir within you, wake you up, give you the strength you need to spread the word in whatever way that you can, and believe. Get out of your locked upper room.
Thank you.
prayer and live into the Holy Spirit. Amen.